Hello everyone, am I audible? Okay, so I think everyone is able to listen to me. So, okay, so let's get begin. And in the last class, we were talking about the 2D array basically, wherein we came to know that in Java, basically the multidimensional arrays are, structured as a array within an array. So we have seen everything related to a complex 2D array, how the structure will be created and how the upper level arrays will contain the lower level arrays and how the element will get inserted and retrieved. So anybody have any doubts in the array? You can ask. Anyone have any doubts? No one has any doubt? Yes, no. Okay. So now we'll just go through one more example related to array, and then we'll start with the OOPS concept, which is again very important things that we have to cover. So basically, in the last class, one of the student, I am not getting the name, was asking that how is it possible to have different length for different arrays in case of multidimensional array like this. So this is one simple example that we took at the end of the last session, wherein I created a 2D integer type array. Okay. And in while creating the array, while declaring the array, which is available on line 5 that I have written, I provided the length of the first array, first dimension array, but for the second dimension, I did not provided the length at all. Which means, so just understood this line of code very carefully, and this is very important thing you should understand. Remember one thing. Yes, session is getting recorded. Session is getting recorded. Okay. So remember one thing, forget about these two lines. Let's say I have declared an array like this. Okay. Wherein I created or defined a 2D array of type integer. I also provided length for the first dimension array, but for the second dimension, I did not provided any length specifically. So if this is the case, you will not be able to insert values into this array at all. If you will try to do so, you will get compile time error. Okay, like just see one of the example. I'll say array of 0, 0 is equal to, let's say, 10. Okay, so not at compile time, but at runtime you will get the error. Just see. So let me execute this. And when I executed this, I must get some error, exception basically. So you can see one exception is getting populated, java.lang.null pointer exception, very, very famous exception in Java, null pointer exception. So basically what is happening here is this. You are trying to insert array of 0, 0 means something like this. You want to say that, let's say, the first dimension of array contains two elements because the length of the first dimension is two. So let's say these are the two elements. And the variable array will point to this particular array. Something like this. And then the second dimension, you did not provided the length at all. So in this case, what is happening that we know that this element and this element will contain 1D arrays. Both of these element will again contain 1D arrays. Okay, but we don't know actually the lengths. And what happens, just understood this. When we declare the length of the array, listen to my words very carefully. Whenever we declare the length of array, based on the length that you have provided, then only the memory will be allocated for that particular array. Like, let's say for an example, I am saying int variable is equal to new int. So here you can see I'm getting a compile time error. Why? Because I have not defined any length to the array, and it is mandatory to define length while creating the 1D array. So what happens if I add, let's say I'm saying the length of the array is 5. As soon as I say that the length of the array is 5, what will happen? Memory will get allocated finally for this array at runtime. But if we do not define any length, JVM will not be able to define any memory, because JVM does not know how many elements you want to insert or have into this array. So until you define the length, memory will not be allocated at all. Similarly, in the 2D array case, although we have defined the length for the first dimension, but we have not defined the length for the second dimension. So in this case, JVM will not be able to create any further 1D array which can be contained in these elements. So this is why at runtime you are getting null pointer exception, because there is no such any arrays means existing at all. Only the first dimension array is there, which has two elements, but there is no more dimension array. Basically the second dimension of arrays are missing. Why? Because we have not defined the length, and until we define the length, the array will not be created at the runtime. So this is the problem with the 2D array or multidimensional array if you do not define the length for the complete dimension. But sometimes what happens, we are required to define different length for the different array in multidimensional arrays. Like, let's say I'm saying array of 0 is equal to new int array of length 3, and array of 1 is equal to new int array of length 10, which means that array of 0 means this variable is pointing to this array, and in this array, for the index, this is the 0th index and this is the first index. So array of 0, which means this element, when I'm saying array of 0, which means this element will contain a 1D array of length 3. So this element is basically containing a 1D array of length 3. And when I'm saying array of 1 is equal to new int array of length 10, which means array of 1, which means this element will again contain a 1D array of length 10. Something like this will happen. So when we say array of zero means array of zero contains a 1D array of length 10, and array of zero contains a 1D array of length 3, and array of one contains a 1D array of length 10. So this can be done if it is required. Okay, anybody have any doubts in this? Anybody have any doubts in this that I have declared here? No? Clear? Okay. Now let me insert values into this array. How I can insert values into this array? So this is very simple. I'll create a for loop for the first dimension array, and I'll begin with array of 0, and I'll say I less than array dot length. And i++. So this for loop will basically, this particular for loop will basically iterate for this first dimension array, for this array. This for loop will iterate for this particular array. And then again, I will create one more array inside this, one more for loop inside this for loop. I'll say int j is equal to 0. What should be the condition here? Because I want to run this for loop both for this arrays who has length 3 and for this array also who has length 10. So what condition should I keep here so that once this for loop will execute 3 times, because length of this array is 3, and for the second time this inner for loop will execute for this array for 10 times because the length of this array is 10. So what condition should I put here? Tell me. Those who are online. Rajat is saying j less than array of I dot length. Okay. Anybody have any other answer? Anyone has any other answer? Or everybody thinks that this will be the condition j less than array of I dot length. Okay, so nobody is responding. So basically, so the condition here will be j less than array of I dot length, and then I'll say j plus plus. What will happen when the value for I will be zero? When the value for the I will be zero, here array of zero dot length, what will be the let's say if the value of I is zero, what will be the complete output? Whatever is selected here, array of I dot length, in case of I is equal to zero, what will get here for array of I dot length? When I is equal to zero, what value will be retrieved from this particular code that I have written? Three? Yes. And what will we get if I is equal to one? What we will get from this array of I dot length? If the value of I is one, 10. Simple. So that's why I have kept here like this array of I dot length. And then I'll say array of I and j is equal to the same math dot random method we will use. So I'll say math dot random multiply by 1000, and I will typecast this into of type in. Okay, so in this line, for each indexes the value will get inserted, and after this line only I will print the value as well. So I'll say array of I comma j. So tell me how many element will get inserted in this complete array? How many element will get inserted in this 2D array? Rajat and Manjeet is saying 13. Anybody have any other answer? 13. Mujahid is also saying 13. Ranbir is also saying 13. Yes, everybody is saying 13. Exactly. 13 value will get inserted. So let me execute this. You can count the values. We have the output here. Let me count everything. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So we have 13 values here inside this 2D array. So I hope now you guys will be able to tell me how to, you know, create multidimensional arrays and how to insert and retrieve values from the array. I hope you will be able to do so. Yes or no? Yes. Okay. So let us do one final exercise here. Let me create a 3D array here, and you guys will tell me how to write the for loop and how to write the code to insert element and retrieve element. So I'll create a class basically here. I'll say 3D array. I'll create a main method here. Now I'm creating a integer array, basically a 3D array of type integer of length. Let's say length is 2, 3, and 4. Now tell me how many elements will get inserted into this complete array. How many elements will get inserted in this? How many elements we can insert in this array? 24. Yes, simple. 2 into 3, 6 into 4, 24 elements. Okay, no, Manjit, not 12, 24 elements basically, 24 elements. Shall I draw the diagram for this as well? Do you want me to show you the diagram? Yes, okay. So see how the diagram will be created. I'll do it. Okay, so just focus here. So the array that we have created is of array of length 2, 3 and 4. So what does it means? 2, 3, 4. Tell me how many elements my second array will contain. How many elements the first array will contain? How many elements the first array? 2. Okay. And what this 3 means is that each element of this first array, okay, each element of this first array will again contain a 1D array which will have 3 elements in that. Okay, so I'm again saying, repeating this again, just listen to my words very carefully. The first dimension of array, the first array will contain 2 elements. Each elements of this array will again contain a 1D array of length 3. And each array of these elements will again contain a 1D array of length 4. Yes or no? This is how you can understand this. Yes or no? Yes. So now let me draw the diagram for this. So basically the diagram will look like something like this. So the first array will contain an array of length 2. So this is the first array for me. The first array of length 2, the dimension, the indexes will be 0 and 1. Then each element of this array, we know that the first array contains 2 elements. This is the first array of length 2. Now each element of this array will contain again 1D array of length 3, like something like this. These are again 1D arrays of length 3. Which means this element contains this array and this element is containing this array. If I write down the indexes, again very easy, the first index will be 0, then first index and then second index. Similarly, 0th index, first index and second index. Now, till this we have drawn. So again, each element of this array will again contain a 1D array of length 4, like this. So now I have to draw multiple diagrams here, but I hope you will be able to understand this. Something like this will happen. So all these third level of arrays contains 4 element, 4 length. Length for all the third level arrays are 4. So let me complete it for you and then we can discuss further. So I'll draw it in a better way so that you can differentiate between the levels. So this is the first level. Then this is our second level of arrays. And then we have third level of array, which is these arrays. Okay, now this contain this array, this element contain this array, this element is pointing to this 1D array. Similarly, this array element is pointing to this array. Something like this will happen. Yes or no? Anybody have any doubt in this? Anybody have any doubt in this? No? Everybody got it? And believe me, nobody is going to tell you something like this. I guarantee this. Okay, now you have to answer my question. I'm not going to write the indexes here, okay? So you just have to tell me. Here I want to insert 100. Tell me how I can insert 100 here. Tell me the code to insert 100 where I have written the 100. Tell how I can insert 100 at that particular index. Tell me the code. Here I want to insert 100. Here. How can I insert 100 here? Ranveer is saying 012, okay. Array of 012, exactly. So now I am relaxed that all of you are getting this, okay? Very important concept and very confusing concept, okay? Because you can see array of 0, 1, and 2, here is the second index for this array. This is pointed by first index of this array, and this array is pointed by 0th index of this array. And this complete array is pointed by array. So if you want to insert 100 here, you have to say array of 0, 1, and 2. Okay. Now, if I want to insert something like this, let's say here I want to insert 500. What I have to say? Array of, what I have to write here to insert 500 here. Final question to everyone. 500 here I want to insert. Array of 100, exactly, array of 100, and array of 100 is equal to 500. So this is how you can create or your diagram, and in order to understand this multidimensional array very carefully, you have to practice like this. Initially you can, you know, draw the diagrams to understand the things better in an easier way. Okay, now let us write the for loop. So how many for loop we will have to write here? How many for loops? Three for loop, because each for loop will handle a particular level of array. Okay, the first for loop will handle the first level of array. The second for loop will handle the second level of arrays. These are the two arrays at the second level. And the final for loop will handle all the third level of arrays. Okay, so now I'll say for int I is equal to 0, I less than array dot length and I plus plus. Then again, what I have to do? Ayush is saying that high sum R of another batch. Can you please tell me when exception handling topic will start? Probably next Sunday, next weekend Sunday, probably. I'm not sure about that. Okay. Yes, next weekend. Yes, next weekend, Ayush. Okay, so the second for loop we have to write is int j is equal to 0. Tell me the condition. What condition should I put here? What condition should I put here? Tomorrow means after this topic, we are going to start packages and import statement today. And tomorrow we'll cover inheritance, overloading, and overriding. Okay. Okay, so here the condition will be j less than array of I dot length j plus plus, and then here I have to write one more for loop. I'll say int I j k is equal to 0. Tell me now what should be the condition here. What should be the condition here? Be careful, take your time, tell me the correct answer. What should be the condition here? No, Ranveer, wrong answer. I told everyone that take your time, tell me the correct answer. Bhavi, write the complete condition. Write the complete condition. Divakar, galat. Wrong answer, Divakar. Here the condition will be k less than array of I comma j dot length and then k plus plus. I hope now everybody understand what I have written here. What my point, why I have written array of I j dot length? Because you cannot reach up to the third label directly using the second level of length, array length. Can you get the length of the second level without using the first level? No. Can you get the length of the third level arrays without using the first level of array? Can you directly say array of j dot length? Can we directly say array of j dot length? No, not at all. Because in order to get the length of the third level of arrays, we have to use the second level of array as well as the first level of array. Why? Because we using this variable, using this array variable, we cannot directly reach up to the second level of array. Got my point? Getting my point, guys? So that's why I cannot simply write k less than array of j dot length, because if I write so, I'll get compile time error. Okay, so I hope now you guys understand. And now finally I will insert values into the array. So I'll say array of what I j and k, whatever value you want to insert. I'll use the same math dot random method. So I'll say math dot random multiply by 1000, and then I'm typecasting this into integer type, and I'll simply print the value as well. So I'll say array of I, J, K. Okay, so now let me execute the code for you. So you can see 24 values are there that have been inserted into the array. So now anybody have any doubts, please see the code and ask your doubt if you have any. Yes or no, tell me, did you understood? Say yes. If you not understood, if you have any doubt, you can ask your doubt. Mujahid has a question. What if we don't want to add random values? If you have to add fixed value with loop, then you can do so. You can add fixed values as well. Now there are n number of scenarios, Mujahid. If you want to have fixed values, so you have to recognize, means you have to first, understood how you are going to provide the values. If you want to hard code the values, then every index of every array will have the same value. Okay, if you want to get it at runtime, then you have to write the scanner class, or you have to use the scanner class methods to, have the values at the runtime. Okay, Mujahid, so you have to, first of all, decide how you're going to insert the values. Do you want to have static values in each and every syntax, each and every index, so that then you can do so. Otherwise, if you want to get the values at the runtime, that also you can do. Okay. I hope this is clear. Mujahid. Okay, Ranbir, do you have any question? Ranveer, do you want to ask any question? Do you have any doubts? Okay, so I hope no doubts are there. Okay, so Vikas is saying where I use three dimensional array. Never. You are not going to use three dimensional array on it. Means I don't think so you'll be able to use and anytime the 3D array, only 2D array will be used maximum to maximum. Rajat, you can create any dimension, any number of dimension array, but you will be using only 2D array at most. Because practically only 2Ds are possible, okay? Ranbir is saying what is the last for loop will be used for? With the last for loop will be used for first level. Ranbir, you can ask your doubt verbally. I'm not getting your question. Please unmute yourself and you can ask your doubt.
Sir, for the first level where the only the two index is there, so for that array the value will be get printed from the last comment only, no, in the means the last for loop which is there. That is the concern.
Please make your question clear. I'm not able to understand your question.
That there are the three levels of array is there, right, sir? Where the first one is 0, 1, and then second level it is the three index is there, and the fourth level, third level it is the length of 5 array is there, right, sir? Four. So the first level of the array, the data will be get printed like how, sir? This one, sir. Yes, sir. 0 and 1. What will be the value will be.
Ranveer, understand this very carefully. When we are inserting the values, I have told this many a times in my previous classes as well. When we are inserting the values, value will get inserted at the last level of array. Here in these arrays, like in these arrays, the value will be inserted. In these arrays, the value will not get inserted because this element already contains. So array of 0 means this element already contains address of this array. This element contain address of this array. So no value you are able to. So when you are saying array, let's say just assume this. Currently value of I is 0. The value is j is also 0. And the value of k is also 0. So when you are saying array of I, j, k, basically you are trying to say array of 0, 0, and 0 is equal to this. Let's say this particular code math.random generated, for example, 520. So what will happen? Inside array of 000, 520 will get inserted. Means array of 000, here 520 will get inserted. You are not going to insert values. We are not going to insert values into these array, neither in the second level of array. We cannot do this because first level of array and second level of array already have values. Which values? The address of the below level of arrays.
Where we are declaring the arrays.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes.
Okay, no problem. Anybody have any other doubt? Okay, so now this is all for the arrays. I have one question here. So quickly we'll go, we'll have few examples. Let's say I'm creating an array of type ABC. Can we do this? Can we do this? Is it possible? Of course it is possible because you are not getting any compile time error. Yes or no? Are we getting any compile time error? No error. Now tell me which type of value we can insert into this array. Which type of value can we insert into this array? Take your time and tell me the correct answer. Divakar is saying string. Jaib is saying char. Hima is also saying string. Ranbir is saying int. Parul is saying ABC. Neha is saying okay. So many are saying different answer. Okay, I have one more question to you guys. So this is a variable. OBJ is a variable of type ABC. You can see OBJ is a variable of type ABC. Tell me, what can I insert in this OBJ? What value can I store into this OBJ, or which type of value can I store into this OBJ? Can I insert integer value into this OBJ variable? Can I insert string into this? Vikas is saying yes. Vikas, can we insert integer value into this? How is it possible, Vikas? This is not possible at all. Data type mismatch ho raha hai na? Here the data type is not matching. The value is of type integer, but the data type of this variable is not integer. Is it possible? Not at all. This is not possible at all. Follow my videos carefully. Okay, Venkat is Vikas, are you understanding my point? I am saying, can we store 10 into this? Not at all, because 10 is an integer value. An integer value can be stored in a variable of type either byte, short, int, long. I hope you remember we have covered this. Venkat is saying we can store here only string. Can we store a string into this variable OBJ? Venkat, is it possible to store a string here into OBJ? Okay, tell me, what is ABC? ABC is a class. Which type of variable this is? OBJ is of which type? What type of variable OBJ is? What type of variable OBJ is? Array? No, Venkat. Rajat is saying static. OBJ reference variable, guys. What you guys are doing? I'm sorry, means I'm not happy with this answer. You guys are not, you know, following my videos properly, I think. Now OBJ is a, so I have told this many a time, that whenever the type of the variable is a class name, a user defined class name, that will be known as a reference variable. Yes or no? ABC is not a class. Array means you have to use big brackets. You can say anything as a, I am saying ABC, do not get confused here. Let me remove that. Now tell me, OBJ is a reference variable, yes or no? Because the data type of OBJ is a class name, basically a user defined class name. Whenever the data type of a variable is a user defined class name, that variable is a reference variable, yes or no? Hello, everyone. Yes, and which type of value can we insert in a reference variable? Which type of value can a reference variable contain? Which type of value can a reference variable contain? A reference variable can contain only the address of an object, yes or no? A reference variable can only contain the address of an object. And which class object? Which class object? In this case, OBJ can contain the address of the object only for the ABC class, yes or no? Yes. Now tell me, can I insert 10 here? Can I insert 10 here in this OBJ? Not at all. Possibly nahi hai. Not possible. Can I insert string here? Can I insert a string here? We can insert a string in a variable only if the data type of the variable is string. Here is the data type of this OBJ variable a string. Have I written string here? No, I have not written string here. So how can I insert string here? Have I written char as the data type for OBJ? Is the data type of OBJ is char? No. So if the data type is not char, we cannot insert characters as well. The data type of this OBJ is ABC. ABC is a user defined class. So whenever the data type of a variable is a class name, basically a user defined class name, that means this variable is a reference variable and we can insert, or this variable can contain only object. Yes or no? Yes. Okay, so just follow the video. So you have time, everybody is sitting at the at home and you have lockdown everywhere. So you have time, just go through the videos and go through the videos seriously, because this is very important things that I'm teaching here. Okay, no worries. These things happen. These things happened with me as well when I was learning Java for the first time. Okay, but then there was no teacher who shouted at me or make me understand why these things are important. Okay, so these are very basic things, very important things. Okay, so follow the videos very carefully. Okay, okay. Now tell me, Vakas, are you understanding this? Okay, okay, great. So now if I create a array of type ABC. Okay, so here what I have created, I have to provide the length of the array. So basically I am creating an array of type ABC. So now tell me what type of value can I insert into this array? I want answer from everyone. No values. Rajat is again saying no values. Basically, this array will contain object of which class? ABC class. That's it. This array will contain object of ABC class. Okay. This array can contain object of ABC class. Why? Because this we have created here, we have created an array of type ABC. Like when we created an array of type integer, what value we can insert there? Only integer values. Let's say if I'm creating an array of type double, I can insert only decimal values. Yes or no? Yes. Similarly, when I created an array of type ABC, I can store values. I can store only the object of the ABC class. Yes or no? Okay. Now tell me how I can insert values into this array. Let me ask you one thing. At index 0, I want to insert an object into this array. Tell me the code what I have to write here. At index 0, I want to insert an object of ABC class. Write the code in the comment section. Quickly, we are, you know, losing the time for the class. Here in this array at index 0, I want to insert an object of ABC class. Write down the code in this section, in this chat. Tell me the code. Vakas, the complete code I want. Complete code, everyone. I want complete code. No, nobody has the correct answer till now. Nobody is able to tell me the correct answer till now. Not pos. Nobody has the correct answer. I am saying at index 0 in this array, I want to insert an object of ABC class. Tell me the correct answer. No, Ayush. Not possible. Why you are inserting character? Nobody has the correct answer till now. Take your time. I'm giving 2 more minutes. Think carefully and then tell me the answer. 2 more minutes. No, Ayush, we cannot insert a string into this array. I have told you that we cannot insert any value other than the object of the ABC class in this array. Inserting a string into this array is not possible at all. We cannot insert a string here in this array because the data type of the array is ABC. No, Manjit, your answer is not correct. Nobody has told me the correct answer till now. I want the actual correct answer. No, Rajat. Yes, Ranbir, you have the right answer. Okay. Ranbir is almost correct. Okay. Okay, so now, before I write down the solution, write down the code here. Let me ask you one question. Tell me which type, what approach did you guys followed? Did you write down the, did you thought about the requirement first of all? Or do you directly jump to the code? I'm sure everybody thought about the code directly. Nobody thought about the requirement first. I hope I'm right. So first of all, the requirement was at the index 0 in this array, I want to insert a value. And in this array, we can insert only object of ABC class. So my requirement was insert object of ABC class in this array at the index 0. This was the requirement. Yes or no? So first of all, think about the requirement. The requirement is to insert object of ABC class in this array at the index 0. This is the requirement. Now to fulfill this requirement, we need one thing. What is that one thing that we need to fulfill this requirement? We need an array of type ABC that we already have. Yes or no? We need an array of type ABC that we have already. Yes or no? Yes. The one other thing that we need is an object of ABC class. Yes or no? Object of ABC class. So my question to everyone that is attending this session is, did you guys first of all thought what all we need to fulfill this requirement? Tell me honestly. Most of the person would not have thought like this. So now I'm saying I need two things. First, I need an object. And then that object I have to assign into the index 0. So first of all, what we have to do? Tell me the first step that we have to do here. First of all, what I have to do here? Create an object of the class ABC. Yes or no? So the step one that we have to do is create an object of class ABC. And the second step, this step is assign that object into the first 0th index of ABC. These are the two steps. So first of all, write down the two steps and then try to convert that steps into code. And your life will be much easier. Please believe me. I hope you guys are getting my point. Okay, so first of all, I need an object of class ABC, and then assign object into index 0 of the array. Yes or no? These are the two things that we have to do. Yes. So first of all, create an object. So I'll say ABC OBJ 1 is equal to new ABC. My first step is done. And then what I have to do? Simple. I'll say array of 0 is equal to OBJ. Yes or no? Sorry, OBJ 1. Yes or no? Here, or also we can do, instead of writing this code, we can do everything in a single line. How? Simply by writing this. Is this possible or not? Yes. So I'm again requesting everyone. Constructor. What constructor you are talking about, Rahul? So follow this approach. Okay, new ABC. So Rahul, do you have any doubts here? No? Okay, great. So follow my approach that I used to follow in my initial phases. I always used to write this, the requirement, analysis the requirement, gather the requirement, the thing that you need to fulfill the requirement, and then write down the steps, and then convert those steps into the code. Understanding my point? Like when you go for an interview for the product-based company, they will ask you for the algorithm. They will never ask you, they will never going to ask you directly the code. They will ask you for the algorithm. What is algorithm? Steps to follow to fulfill the requirement, that is nothing but an algorithm. So the product-based companies are not concerned about the coding part. They are more concerned about the algorithm. What algorithm you are choosing to complete that or fulfill that requirement. So you have to, you know, come through the steps, and then you can convert these steps into the code. So is this clear to everyone? Yes. Okay. Now final question. What type of value can this array contain? The second array that I've created, what type of value can this array contain? String. Okay. Insert any string into this array at the index 1. Write the code here. Tell me the code to insert any string, whatever string you want to insert at the index 0 for this array. Tell me the code. Insert any string at the index 1 in this array. At index 1 in this array. Okay, Rajat, you are almost correct. I was saying to insert values at the index 1. So that is fine. I know you are getting the thing. Okay. So this is how you have to think. Yes, everybody has the correct answer. Okay, one final question here. Let me create one more class here. Your assignment right now, we have to do it. Okay, let me do one thing. Public void add. Array 1 is equal to array 2 is equal to what are these things? What is these two things? Two integer array I have created here. Yes or no? Two integer array I have created, and at the same time I have initialized the values as well. Yes or no? Yes. Okay, so assignment, the task for you guys is to pick each indexes from each array, like pick the value of index 0 from first array and from second array. I'm repeating it again. Pick 0th index value from both the array. Add those two values. Okay. Like first of all, pick 0th index value from array 1, which is 1. And 0th index value from array 2, which is 11. 1 and 11. Add both of these two values, which is 12. And insert that addition value into third array 0th index. Okay. Finally, in the third array, you will have 5 values. Yes or no? What you guys need to do is return that third array from this method. Return that third array from this method. Did you guys understood the problem? First of all, tell me, anybody have any confusion in understanding the problem? Ask me. Everybody understood it? Okay, I'll repeat it again. What you guys needs to do is, we have two arrays here, array 1 and array 2. Both of these array have 5 elements each. Okay, the task is to pick 0th index value from each array. Like, you have to pick each, from each array you have to pick specific index value. Like, from array 1 and array 2, first of all pick 0th index value. So I picked, first of all I picked 1 and 11, because the both of these values are at the same index, 0th index. Then add these two values, which will be 12, and then insert this value into a third array at the 0th index. Then pick first index value from this array and this array, which is 2 and 12. Add both of these two values, which is 14. Insert this value, which is 14, into a third array's first index. Similarly, pick next index value from both of these array, add those two values, and insert the final value in a third array. So this is what you have to do. And finally, in the third array, you will have 5 elements. What you have to do is return that final array, the third array, from this method. That is what you have to do. Yes, the third array will be the summation of both of these two arrays values. Yes, it is just like addition of matrix. Now tell me how you are going to perform this. Do you want to do it right now, or do you want to take it as a home assignment? Okay, so before coming to next class, tomorrow's class, you have to revert me with the answer over the email or over the WhatsApp group, however you want to revert it, the solution to me. You just have to communicate with your solution to me. Okay. Did everybody understood the question? Honestly, if you have any doubts, you can ask, because I'm not going to, you know, tell the answer right now. You have to, you know, use your logic to write down the code. Okay. Okay. No worries. So we'll see this again tomorrow. We'll come to this question tomorrow in the beginning. Now let us jump to this next topic that I wanted to cover today. So let me do one thing. The topic that we are going to cover now is packages. Dheeraj is saying how to find duplicates in an array. Okay, we'll do this tomorrow. Okay. So in the beginning, just remind this question. Tomorrow we'll do this in the beginning of the session. Okay, but please remind me this at the beginning. Okay. Make sure that you remind, you are making me go through this question at the beginning of the session tomorrow. Okay. Okay, so now let us begin with packages. So tell me, what is packages in Java? What is packages? You can see we have created n number of packages here. Why do we create packages? What are packages in Java? Collection of class, okay. Anybody have any other answer? Collection of classes, okay. Anything else? The next collection of classes, okay. To keep the class, okay. Anybody have any other answer? Collection of projects, no. Inside project, we create packages. We do not create projects inside a package. We create packages inside a project, okay. So collection of projects is not correct. Parul saying logical collection of classes and interface. What is logical collection of classes? Group of classes. Okay. Collection of classes and interface. Okay. Now tell me one. Let me tell you one thing. In your laptop, in your system, whatever system you have, you must be creating folders in your system or in your laptop. Like you must have created a video folder or a movie folder where you must have begin create, you know, collecting all the movies that you have in your laptop. Like you have a MP3 folder where you are, you know, collecting all the songs. You have, let's say, study material named folder where you are having all these study materials with you. Let's say you have a photos kind of folder where you are having all the photos in your laptop. Like this you create, yes or no? We everybody create folders in our system, yes or no? Okay, why do we create these folders? Why don't we keep everything in a single folder? Why do we create separate folders to store different type of files in different folders? For ease of identification. Yes, to maintain the things properly. Okay, because it is very easy to search unique identification. So basically what we do in our system is we group similar type of files in a folder. Yes or no? So that when we are required to find any particular file, it will be easier for us to find a particular file. Yes or no? Yes. So basically we create folders to store similar type of files together. Okay. Sometimes what happens, you must have experiences that let's say our desktop get full. And what we do, we create new folder and we copy paste cut paste everything in a new folder name folder. Yes or no? You must have experienced this. And in that case, what happens? Finding the things becomes very difficult for us. Yes or no? Yes. The same thing happens with any programming language. The same thing happens in any programming language. Because when we do, when we write code, when we create application, when we create a software, we have to write down multiple line of codes. We have to create multiple classes. We have to create multiple files. We have to create multiple interfaces. We have to have multiple things to, you know, create a project. Yes or no? So to make the thing manageable, what we do, we create packages. And packages we create to have similar type of files in a single place so that finding the files, managing the files becomes easier for a developer. otherwise the things will be hell kind of thing for you. Let's say application like Facebook. Can you tell me how many classes would have been created to create an application like Facebook? Thousands of classes would have been created. I'm sure about that. Thousands of classes at least. Because the application is such a big application, the functionalities are so huge, you cannot have all the line of code in a single class. So you have to create different classes. And all those classes will not be of same type. Like if in our project, you can see that I have created multiple packages. Like for array examples, I have a separate package. For loops, I have a separate package. For methods example related classes, I have a separate package. I've created these separate packages so that it will be easier for you guys to find the things, or it will be easier for me to find the class files. Yes or no? So packages are nothing but a package is the grouping of related files providing access protection and namespace management. So we'll talk about this access protection in a minute, but right now just understand this namespace management. Namespace management means managing the files, group of related files in a particular folder. Basically packages are nothing but folder only. But in programming language, basically in Java, we call those folders as a package. But packages are nothing but folders only. Okay. So packages are created by using the keyword package, and it should be the first line of a source file. In order to use the classes of other packages, read this line very carefully. Read this point very carefully. In order to use classes of other packages, we have to use import statement. Okay, so now understand the things very carefully. We know that we create packages so that we can group same type of files together, so that finding the files, managing the files becomes easier for us. I hope this is clear to everyone. Okay, now apart from a management perspective, there is few more important things which are related to packages, okay, which you guys have to understand. Now you must have heard about the access modifiers like public, private, protected and default modifier. Yes or no? Now why these modifiers are there in Java? What is the use of these modifiers in Java? To provide access protection, to decide the accessibility of a particular thing. Yes or no? Like if a thing is a private, if a class is a private class, we cannot create a private class, sorry. But let's say a variable is a private variable, a method can be a private method, a method can be a public method. So we use these access modifier to provide the access protection. So packages have many important things in Java. First of all, packages we create to group similar type of files in a single folder for management perspective. Second thing is that the access modifiers that we have in Java, like the public, protected, default and private access modifier, all these access modifiers works on the basis of packages. The functionality of any access modifier depends, or basically is depending upon the packages. And also, if you want to use a class of any other package, you have to import the class. You must have experienced this, like when we were using scanner class, we have to import the scanner class first of all. Yes or no? Yes, why? Because we were using scanner class, which has been created in a different packages. So in Java, just remember this, whenever you are trying to use a class of some other package, you have to import the class. Otherwise, compile time error will be there. Okay. So if you want to use a class of some other packages, you have to import the class. Okay. So all these things are, you know, based on the packages. So now what I'll do, I'll do one thing. Everything is depending upon the class, packages. I'll talk about this, Rajat. So just wait for this. Just be with me, give me some time and everything will be clear to everyone. So let me do one thing. Let me create few packages. And first of all, forget about the access modifier or the import statement. First of all, understand why creating package is important. First of all, understand that particular thing. Why creating package is important, that we have to understand first. Otherwise, you will not be able to get the importance of a package. Okay. So how we are going to understand this? Let me just take one example here. Now, you must have seen that in the initial classes, in the starting classes, I do not created any packages. I just right click on the SRC folder and I created new class. You must have seen that. Yes or no? Yes. Now, when I did not created a class in a specific package, and when I directly created the class directly by right clicking the SRC folder, what did happen? Where that particular class goes? In the default package? Yes or no? Everyone, yes or no? You can see here there are n number of classes available in the default package. Like, let's say I'm creating a new class. I'm directly clicking on the SRC folder and I'm creating a new class. Let's say I'm creating a class with name A. So as soon as I will create this class, you will see that that particular class went into the default package. Yes or no? Yes. Who created this default package? Who created this default package? Did I created the default package? No, Eclipse created the default package. JVM does not create package. JVM does not do anything. Does not, at runtime, nothing will be created. Whatever you have created, whatever you have written, that will be executed at the runtime by the JVM. Make this thing very clear. JVM does not create any package at runtime. JVM does not create any class at runtime. JVM does not create a line of code at the runtime. Whatever you have created, whatever file you have, whatever line of code you have written, that will be executed by JVM. Okay. So default package will be created by Eclipse. It was created by Eclipse. I did not create the default package. Someone was asking, what if we have multiple default class? Is it possible? Is it possible to have multiple packages of same name? Can we create multiple class of same name? Rajat is saying yes. Can we create multiple packages of same name? No, we actually, what happens? There is no default package at all. Default package that you are seeing here, we'll come to that, Dheeraj. Just wait. Why you are so in a hurry? Just wait. I have not come to that point. Okay. We'll come to that point. Okay. Actually, default package never gets created. It's a virtual package. You don't believe me? Just see, I'm showing you. So let me go to the directory, the folder where this project has been created. Because somewhere this project would have been saved in my local system, yes or no? Yes, let me go to the folder that contains this project. So let me go there. How can I reach there? Just right click here on the project, go to properties. This is the folder where my project is there. So I'll directly go here. So this is the folder, this is the package. You can see here, the project name here is online_java_batch_1. The same folder you can see. So this has been created in this C drive in our folder. Go inside this. Inside the SRC folder, you will have all the packages, all the classes. go inside the SRC. Can you see a folder with name default package? Can you see the default folder here? Default package folder here? No. Why do we don't have the default package here? Basically, packages are nothing but folder. No, it's not hidden at all. It's not hidden at all. Basically, it never gets created. Because can you see whatever classes that you see in the Eclipse under the default package? Look at this very carefully. Whatever class that you see here in the default package in the Eclipse, those classes are directly under the SRC folder. Can you see this? Class A, declaring primitive variables, object creation, string example, student test. All these classes you can see here in the default package in the Eclipse. But all these classes are not inside any folder. These are directly under the SRC folder. Why? Because actually default package does not get created. This is a virtual package that you see here, which has no meaning. Default package has no meaning. Did you get my point, everyone? And also, in the first class in the Java, in the demo class, I have covered this, that there is a rule to define the identifier. Identifier means whether that identifier is a variable name or a method name or a class name or a package name. There is a rule. What is that rule? Rule to define an identifier. What was the rule? Tell me, guys, what was the rule? Rules to define an identifier in Java. The first rule was, any identifier, whether that identifier is a variable name, a method name, a class name, or a package name, it should begin with the first character of any identifier should be either alphabet, or it can be underscore, or it can be a dollar symbol. The second characters can be anything: alphabets, digits, underscore, or a dollar. And the third point was that we cannot use any special character other than underscore and dollar. Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes. See here. Here the name of the package is bracket, default space package, then a bracket. Yes or no? What is the first character name, first character for this package name? Parenthesis. Is parenthesis possible in an identifier? No. So which means this is not possible at all. Actually, this package does not exist at all. This is just a virtual package created by Eclipse, which actually does not exist. I hope you got my point. Okay, yes or no? One more proof I'll show you. It is mandatory what it says. Packages are created by using keyword packages. It should be the first line of any source file. What is source file? What is a source file in Java? What is a source file in Java? What is source file in Java? The .java file? The .java files, yes or no? The .java files, yes or no? Yes. Whenever you create .java file, in the .java file, the first statement must be the package name where you have created that particular Java file. I am again repeating it. The first statement of any source file, any Java file, should be the package declaration, the package where you have created that particular Java file. And one more thing you should remember, if you have not created the Java file in a particular specific package, if you are directly creating the Java file directly under the SRC folder, there will be no package statement in that particular source file. And if you have created the Java file in a particular package, the first statement in that source file must be the package statement. Just see here. Let me show you that for your confirmation. So what I can do, let me close every file. First of all, see here. Let me open this class, declaring primitive variables dot java file. Do you see any package statement? Do you see any package statement here? Why don't we see here? Why there is no package statement here? Can you tell me why there is no package statement here? Because this file is not created in any package. If a file is not created in a package, how can be there a package statement? Okay, now see, let me open any of the Java file from this array example package. Let me open this. What is the first statement here? The package statement. This is mandatory to have. If a file is inside any package, there must be a package statement in the source file. I'm again repeating it. This is very important. If the source file, if the Java file is being created in any package, the first statement must be the package statement. If I remove it from here, you will get compile time error. You can see the compile time error. It says the declared package does not match, means the package statement must be here. Let me open any other file, sample.java from here. You can see the package statement here, because this sample.java was created inside the methods package. So I hope now this is clear. Clear to everyone? Clear to everyone, yes or no? Package statement must be the first statement of any source file in a Java. If the source file is not been created in a package, directly created in a source folder, then there will be no package and you cannot write down the package statement. Use wise difference will come to that. Whatever I have covered till now, anybody have any doubt? Anybody have any doubt? No. Now the next important thing. Can you please repeat? Okay, Hema, I'll repeat it again. I'll repeat it again. Okay. Rajat is saying, sir, then .java files which have been created default package don't have access to other packages. I will come to this, Rajat. This is correct point. I'll come to this. Okay, Rajat, just be with me. I'll come to this. Okay, let me repeat this again. Whenever you create any source file means .java file. In a .java file, the first line of code must be the package statement. This is the syntax for the package statement. This is nothing but a package statement. Package statement. Package statement means the first line of code in any .java file must be a package statement, which means first of all, you have to use a keyword package and the name of the package where you have created this particular source file. Like if you see sample.java is created in which package? Sample.java is created in which package? Methods. Then that's why we have written here methods. Why? Because this source file has been created in which package? Methods package. But package statement begins with a package keyword, then the name of the package where you have created the source file. Now I hope you understood it, Hema. Okay, now anybody have any doubts? Yes or no? No. No doubt? Okay. Now the next importance of packages are sometimes, not sometimes, many a times you will have to use a class of another package in a class of other package. In that case, you have to import the other package class. You must know this. I hope you know these things. That in order to use a class of other package, you have to import the class first. Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes? Yes? Okay. And when you import the class, What is the syntax of importing the class? Syntax to import any class. Syntax to import any class. Syntax is, first of all, you have to use a keyword import, then package name, then dot, then class name, then semicolon. This is the syntax to import a class. Okay, what is the syntax? The syntax to import any class is, first of all, you have to use a keyword import, then space, then package name, then dot class name. It means you are importing a class which belongs to a package, whatever package name you have provided. Okay, is this clear? Is this syntax clear to everyone? Now tell me one thing, if the class does not belongs to any package, will you be able to import the class? If the class does not belongs to any package, will you be able to import that class? No, because in order to import any class, providing the package name is mandatory. Providing the package name before the class name is mandatory. So if the class does not belongs to any package, will be able to import that? Not at all, which means whatever class you see in the default package, you will not be able to import any of these classes and any of the other class of other packages. Did you get it? Why creating package is important in Java? If the class does not belongs to any package, you will not be able to import that particular class in other packages. Now I hope you guys understood the importance of package, at least in Java. Yes or no? Tell me that. What my point, everyone? Yes, so that's why packages are important, because importing any class depends upon the package. If the class does not belongs to any package, you will not be able to use that class in other package. So that's the importance of packages. I hope you understood this very carefully. Clear? Hello? Yes? Okay, now as we have understood the importance of package, now we will cover how to import a class in Java. There are multiple ways. There are a few important things related to import statement that we should understand before we move to the access modifier. So now we have covered the importance of packages. Now we will cover the import statement, how to import a class in Java, and then we will go to the access modifier concept. Is this clear? Clear? Okay, now let us begin with the import statement. What is import in Java? So let me do one thing for you guys. Let me create few packages here. Let's say I'm creating P1 package. And P3 package. So I have created three packages here. Okay, now let me create a class in the P1 package, test class. Okay, I have one more class here in the P1 package, which is, let's say, home class. Okay, now both of these classes are in same package. Home class and test class are in same package. Okay, great. Now, let us say in the test class, I have a method, let's say public void add. There I'm not doing anything specifically. I'm just printing the message that this is add method of test class of P1 package, just to recognize that this method belongs to which class and this class belongs to which package. Okay, clear? And then here I have a main method. Okay, what I want is, in the main method, I want to call this add method. How can I call this add method in the main method here? In the same class, I want to call this add method in the main method. How can I do this? I want to call the add method here in the main method. How can I do this? Ranveer is saying test dot add. Why, Ranveer? We have to create object. Why? Because add is a non-static method, non-static property. And to call a non-static property, what we should use? Object always. Okay. So what I'll do here is, I'll create the object of the test class. First of all, test t is equal to new test I created, and then I'll say t dot add. And if I execute this, you will see that the method is getting executed. Anybody have any doubt in this? This is very simple. Okay. Now, do I have to import the test class here to call this add method? I was not required to import the test class to call this add method here. Why? Why I did not imported the test class here to call this add method? Because this method belong to the same class, and we are calling the same method in the same class where we have declared that. Forget about the package. Same class. This methods belong to the same class where we are using this method. Yes or no? Okay. Okay. So we don't have to import the test class because we are calling the same method in the same class where we have declared that. Okay. Clear to everyone? Parul is saying, can we write directly add method? No, this is not possible, Parul. This is not possible. Why? So Parul, is this your first class? So you are from some other batch, right? Who is taking the Java class there? Who is the Java trainer there in that batch? Hello? Paril, are you there? Okay, Ayush is taking the Java class there. Okay. Okay, so Parul, basically, the thing is that okay, so understand this, Parul. This is very common basic thing which I have already covered in my class, but I'll repeat it again. Main is a static method, okay, and the add method is a non-static method. So in Java, we cannot call non-static method directly in the static method. The reason being is that basically for here in the case of main method will be called directly by the JVM at the time of execution without having the object created. So to call the main method, we have to do nothing. JVM will call the main method directly. Okay. And in the when, let's say the method, main method got executed, and here you have said that call the add method. But add method is a non-static property. And non-static property can never be called in a static method directly. That is not possible in Java. Okay, so you have to use object to call a non-static property in a static method. You can see here it says cannot make a static reference to a non-static method from the type test, because both are different in functionality. Non-static property requires object to be accessed. Static property do not requires object to be executed or to be called up. So that's why we will not be able to call the add method directly in the main method. Okay. Okay, so what was I saying? I forgot. Okay, so I created object of the test class and I called the add method. I need not to import the thing. Now what I want is, in the home class I have a main method here as well. What I want is, I want to call the add method of the test class in the main method of the home class. Now both home and test class are available in same package. So how can I call the add method of test class here in the main method of home class? Tell me the code to do that. What I have to do here? Ranveer is saying by import, okay. Creating object of test class by using class name. No, Hema. Ranveer is saying test class import. Okay, creating object a dot add. What is a? Okay, first create the object. Okay, so first of all, let me tell you one thing which you guys should remember always. You should think about importing a class at the end. First of all, decide, do you need the class name or do you need the object to call that particular property? Forget about the import statement. Okay, forget about the import statement. You should always focus on the approach through which you can call that particular property. Do you require to have object? Do you need class name? That is more important. Thinking about the import is the last thing. Like when I was teaching the methods, I told you guys that decide about the return type at the end. The same way, decide about importing a class at the end. First of all, decide, do you need class name here or object here? That is more important. So now tell me, I want to call the add method in the main method of home class. Do I have to use object or can I call the add method directly using class name? Class name, Ranveer is saying class name. Vikas is saying object. Manjit is saying object. What about the rest? Do I need to use class name or object? Class name. Rahul is saying class name. Hema is saying class name. Object. Okay. Why class name? Those who are saying class name, why class name? Tell me. Why class name? Those who are saying class name, why class name? Many of you are saying class name. Tell me why class name is required here. Because we declared it as a public. Okay. What about rest? Like Ranveer is also saying class name. Rahul is also saying class name. Why class name? Ranveer, why class name? We have used it in the class test. Okay. when do we use class name to call a property? And when do we use object to call a property? When do we use class name to call a property? Which type of property should be called by class name? Which type of property should be called as a class name? Static. Class is static. Class is never static, Venkat. So static property should be called by class name. Yes or no? Hema, Rahul, and Ranveer, everyone. Yes. Is add method a class, a static method? The add method that we have in test class, is add method is a static method? No. Then how we can call that using class name? Is that possible? Not at all. Remember one thing, wherever in world you are using class name you can access only static property. Non-static property cannot be called using class name. And here add method is a non-static property. I have taken this class 2-3 weekends ago and this must have been clear to everyone. Why still you are getting confused? Okay, this is not acceptable. Okay, follow the lectures very carefully. It is for your benefit. Okay, so if just for example, let's see, if I say test dot, I'll not be able to add method. I'll not be able to call the add method. Why? Because add is not a static method. So what I have to do is, first of all, I have to create object of the test class here. And then using object, I can call the add method. Clear to everyone? Now, did I imported the test class here? No, I did not import. I did not imported the test class. Why we don't require to import the test class here? Because of same package. Because both of the classes belongs to the same package. Okay, same package class. If you are using a class of same package in some other class of same package, if both of the classes are of same package, we don't have to import the class. Okay, is this clear to everyone? Clear? Okay, now let me do one more thing. Let us create one more class in the P2 package. I am creating a sample class in the P2 package. And in this sample class, I have a main method. Now what I want is, I want to call the add method, which is in the test class, in the main method of the sample class. How can I do this? I'm again repeating, think about the import statement at the end. Tell me the approach first, what I need to call the add method of the test class in the main method of the sample class. Object or class name? We need object, right? Object of test class. Okay. Okay. So let me create object of test class. So now in the sample class main method, I'll create the object of the test class. And then I will say obj dot add, and what we can see is we are getting error here. Are we getting error here? Why we are getting the error? Why we are getting the error here? This is in the other package. Okay, Ranbir is saying different package. Package we need to import, different package, unable to get the definition of class. There is no test class in P2 package. Absolutely correct. Package was not imported. Those who are saying that we have to import the test class is the solution of this problem, not the reason behind this problem. First of all, understand the reason behind the problem. Then we will get the solution easily. Okay, whenever in your IT industry, when you are doing automation or in your life as well, when you have any problem, first of all, get the reason behind the problem. If you know the reason, you will get the solution. Yes or no? Yes. Now understand the reason behind this problem. Now tell me where we are getting the error, when we are calling the add method or when we creating the object of the test class. Where are we getting the compile time error? When we creating the object or when we are calling the method? While creating the object? While creating the object, yes or no? Yes. Now, while creating the object at the line number 5, where exactly are we getting the exception? Under the variable obj variable name or under the equals to operator or under the new keyword or under the parenthesis? Where are we getting the under the test class name? Under the class name. Under the class name, we are getting the compile time error. Yes or no? Basically, what happens? Why importing a class is important? Understand this, the reason very carefully. When you write down the code in the main method at the line number 5, test obj is equal to new test. Basically, you want to access the test class here. Yes or no? Basically, you want to use the test class here. Yes or no? Yes. You are trying to use test class in which class? You are trying to use test class in which class? Sample class. Okay. Now tell me the class which you want to use and the class where you want to use, are both class same or different? Different, because you want to use test class in which class? Sample class. Are both class same? No, different class. So how the compiler decides that you should import the class, understanding that flow will make your life very easy. Understanding that is very important. When compiler will tell you to import a class, you have to understand this very carefully. Okay, for that I'll take one example here. In the test class, first of all, I created the add method, okay? And then I created the main method. And in the main method at line number 12, what I am doing? I am creating the object of test class. Yes or no? Yes or no? Now at line number 12, which class you want to access? Test class, okay. Now the class that you want to access and the class where you are trying to access that class, are both class same or different? Same. Arey bhaiya, different kaise ho gaya, Rahul? Both are same class. You are here, you are accessing text class. And where you are accessing it? Inside the test class, because all the complete code that you have written here are in the test class. Okay, so both of the class are same. No worries, no worries. So when classes are same, compiler will be relaxed. He will not trigger the import button. Okay. So when both the class are same, compiler will be relaxed. Like, yeah, both are same, both classes are same, no need to import anything. Okay. Which means when you are accessing same class in the same class where you have you are trying to access, if the classes are same, no need to do anything. Compiler will not raise any concern. Okay, clear? Yes or no? Hello? Yes. Now come to the same package, home class. Now here as well. Now here in the home class, you are trying to access which class? Test class. And where you are calling? In home class. Are both class same? Are both class same? No. Now what will happen? Just see how what the compiler will do, just see that. Now the compiler got to know that this class which you are accessing in the home class are not same. Then what the compiler will do? Okay, check for package. Now understand the flow. You are accessing test class in home class. Both class are different. Now what will do, what compiler will do that? It will check that home class belongs to which package. Because actually you are accessing the test class in the home class. Now the compiler will find out that the home class belongs to which package. So tell me, home class belongs to which package? P1. So now what compiler will do is, it will search in the P1 package that is there any class in the P1 package with name test. If there is a class with name test in P1 package, the compiler will be relaxed. It will not raise any alarm. If the P1 package does not contain a class with name test, then the compiler will raise the alarm. Why? Because understand this, compiler will allow you to use the class of the same packages only. Compiler cannot identify classes of other packages at his own. Compiler cannot decide, cannot define, or cannot identify the classes of other packages at his own. Understood my point? So here the compiler will look only till package one. If package one contains test class, that is fine. Otherwise, the compiler will raise alarm and it will ask you to import the class, because compiler will not go understand that which home class or which test class you are talking about. The test class belongs to which package, you have to tell the compiler by using import statement. Understood? The same thing is happening here in the sample class. What is happening here? You are accessing test class in the sample class. Now both class are different. Yes, both class are different. So now what will happen? Compiler will look in which package? Compiler will find the test class in which package? P2 package. And is there any class with name test in P2 package? No,